Morning. Hey, we're glad you're here this morning. If you would stand, greet one another. I know some of you have the routine down by now and you are already doing that, and that's great. But greet one another, greet the others as they come in. Join with us this morning as we worship the Lord. Thank you.
we thank you for your goodness and we thank you for your kindness towards us. And we do just say, come and have your way this morning. Come and have your way. We've come to bring you glory. Lord, teach us the ways of surrender. Teach us the ways of yielding to you, yielding to the Holy Spirit. Lord, we just invite the fullness of who you are to come and to manifest this morning. The fullness of who you are, Holy Spirit, Father God, Jesus Christ the Son, come and manifest who you are. God, open our eyes to see you in a whole new way. Lord, so we just say yes to you this morning. Yes to your will and yes to your way. There is no one like you, God. Truly, there is no one like you. So, Lord, we worship you this morning, all that we are and all that we have. How beautiful is your name.
May there be a yes in my heart. May there be a yes in my heart.
turned on you. May there always be a yes in our spirit, a yes in our song. God, you come and you take the hearts of stone and you give us a heart of flesh. God, may we be moldable in your hands. May we be like clay that is soft in the hands of the potter. Not hard, but soft. Yielded, submitted, moldable in your hand. God, we trust your heart. We trust your ways. Even though you go beyond what our mind understands, we trust your ways. We trust your heart. And God, we just give you glory this morning.
Places that the enemy had entrenched himself, maybe in our lives, or even our city, or our nation, in the world. And I heard that we were going to go in and take the places that the enemy has stolen, the places where he is encamped and the places where he's dug in. But I saw these places as just being vacant. And I felt like the harvest is ripe and it's ready. But I felt like what was going to lead us into this place was our praises. Just the praises on our lips is what was going to give us authority to go into these places. Take back this territory.
And I sing praises to your name. No praises to your name. The name that's so much higher than all names. And all honor to your name. And all honor to your name, the name that's so much greater than all names.
I sing praises.
And I sing praises to your name. No praises to your name. So much higher than all names. All honor to your name.
his life.
Your name is life. Your name is hope inside me. It's hope inside me. And your name is love. A love that always finds me. It always finds me. Your name.
Thank you.
hear the Lord just saying this morning that he is sending a cutting wind this morning. I see that some of us here this morning, it's like that we've got sails that are going in opposite directions. We've got sails that are will blow with the wind if it goes this way, and one if it'll go that way. I know that in the natural that's not physically possible. The sail goes each way, but I saw two sets of sails, and it was like one of them was pulling against the momentum that the Lord wanted to bring today. And the Lord said he was sending a cutting wind right now to rip every sail right now that is dealing with double-mindedness and anxiety today, wondering if it's really for you. I feel like the Lord just is saying today, he's saying, my wind will cut through every bit of anxiety. My wind will cut through into healing right now. There's healing right now this morning for joints right now. If you've got that problem, just begin to move right now and receive it. He wants to send this thing. It's going to cut and cut and cut. Just like it says, his word is like a sword that divides between the soul and the spirit. The Lord says, I am moving right now to cut off the unhealthy parts of the soul where it has driven you into, driving in you into the rocks and the shores where it's not for you. I have a wind here that's going to bring you into a safe harbor where you'll be loaded up with goods and sent out again. I just see like this picture of where the ship comes into this safe harbor and all these goods are loaded up. And I even see like these maps being offered for treasure. So we thank you that that's here this morning, Lord, that you are releasing the treasures of your loving kindness this morning that we can discover. Jesus.
I saw the wind of the Lord's coming, not only to bring change, but to create a space for relationship, to drive back every obstacle, every issue that's keeping you from communion with the Lord, and to have this moment where you walk with the wind of the Lord, with the Ruach, the breath of God. And in that place, you'll become into a deeper place of union with the Lord, so much so that your mouth will be His and your walk will be His. And I just really feel like the Lord is really sending this wind right now. And John said something a minute ago to me, and he said straight line winds, and I heard that. And so we're going to prophesy that there's going to be some, it may happen in the natural too, so get ready. But I just saw straight line winds come. You know, straight line winds bring a shaking. I've had them, I was in my car one time and they came, they blew the windows out of my car. And it's just like it suddenly it comes. And the Lord said, I'm about to send a straight line wind your direction. And just when you think it's all at one place, you'll be at another place. And it's going to begin to change the atmosphere immediately. So get ready, the Lord says, for a new season where one moment you're in one season and the next moment you're in a new season. Lord, so we prophesy straight line winds in the Spirit that they would come and be a sign and a wonder to us that we are in a new season with you. We declare that this morning.
Father, as the body, I want to come into agreement with your word to us today. We say yes in our spirit. We say yes in our heart. Winds of the heavens come, blow in our life, and we are in agreement with the change that you're releasing in our midst today. We say yes, 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 Lord.
Father, we embrace. Are you ready? We embrace the winds of change. Lord, bring it for our lives, for our city, for our state, for our nation. Lord, we just declare the winds of change are moving to bring about the needed change, to bring your kingdom into a greater manifestation in the earth. Open our hearts today to this transformation. Open our own hearts, Father, that what the change we're going to experience personally, and that we'd walk in everything that you've declared and written about us. We give you praise this morning. We thank you for doing that right now. In Jesus' name. Everybody receive that. Say amen. All right, look at your neighbor and say, change is coming to your life. All right? Just declare that. All right. Okay, do it. Okay. They said their next song is let's do it. Don't
the wind.
Catch the wind. That's the name of the next song.
That's
all right?
So funny.
I did not know that.
You want to catch
so
the
I
wind?
Can't just like pause here. We have to go.
Okay,
all right. So you can sit if you have to, stand if you need to.
Oh, I am strong and full of life, and I am steadfast, no compromise. I lift my sails to the sky. I'm gonna catch the wind, I'm gonna catch the wind. Spread Actually five of the metal balls, and I just kept singing them swing, you know, one on the end swings, hits the center, the other swings out. And so I just looked it up, and it says it's a device that demonstrates conservation of momentum and energy using a series of swinging spheres. When one sphere at the end is lifted and released, it strikes the stationary spheres, and a force is transmitted through the stationary spheres and pushes the last sphere upward. And so I just began to ask the Lord, like, what was this picture? What was this about? And at first, when I first came in, the Lord was really speaking to me about the core, and that he was bringing some real strength to the core and our core beliefs, what we stand for. And then when I saw this picture, I really believe it has a lot to do with just the movement, the energy of the Lord. That the Lord's come to move and shift some things. And that I actually saw him as he begins to pull some of us upward and release us. As we begin to move and do what we were created to do, it'll begin to hit, and it actually causes motion in other people. So Lord, I just thank you right now that you are raising up a generation, Lord, that we will not operate out of fear of man, that we will not hold back, Lord, that we will begin to know, Lord, our core strength, Lord, what we believe in, what we stand for, why, God, Lord, and then you would begin to pull us back and pull us upward and release us into what we're called to do. Lord, I thank you that the momentum and the energy, Lord, as we begin to move and operate in what we were called to, Lord, that it will actually become a chain reaction. So, Lord, I thank you for your wind. I thank you for your movement. Lord, we just grab a hold of that this morning. Let us not be stagnant. Lord, let us feel the motion of your presence. Lord, let us feel the motion of your Holy Spirit, that we would know when you're calling us upward, when you're releasing us out.
It's that shift of seasons. As soon as that thing was hit, we go upward. It's like a straight line wind. It goes in a straight line. When you do that device, it goes in a straight line, and you go up to a new level. So, Lord, we just release that word here. We're catching the wind of what you're saying today. We're going upward to the high calling of Christ. Each one of us, Lord, we just decree that this morning. All right, Father, Lord, now we just seal it, we receive it, and we're going to walk in it. Amen? Everybody say amen again. All right, now look at your neighbor. Now catch the wind. All right, there we go. Bless you. That was awesome. Good, 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 good. Good morning. Okay. Also remind you, John, why don't you come talk about Burning Man for a second? And I know Kim and Jeff and y'all are going. They asked us to announce that. Okay, I think they wanted.
We were going to do a little kind of a celebration meal for all of our counselors that helped at kids camp. And so we had planned to do it this morning after church, but we're actually going to wait, and we're going to do it Wednesday night. So if all of our junior counselors that helped us at youth camp, and y'all were amazing, y'all did so great, we're going to meet on Wednesday night in the multipurpose room for youth, okay? And then also, we have a sign-up sheet. Did we? I don't know where Lindy is. Lindy, we have a sign-up sheet. Is it in the back? Okay, awesome. It's in the back, and for our nursery. So we have been so blessed to have the Go Ministry girls here just to serve us and love on our babies, and they have done such an amazing job. But they're going to be kind of taking their summer break for 6 weeks. So I have the honor of announcing that y'all get to love on your babies, and it is the highest call, and they are such a blessing. So if you can, if you have a child in the nursery, it's going to be required. We're going to sign our names up, and we're going to serve. And as many people as we have, Wednesday nights are covered, so we just need help on Sunday morning for 6 weeks. So I think as many people as we have, we'll just be in there one Sunday. So I'm really excited just that y'all get to be a part and just to see what the Lord's doing in our kids, too. So that's in the back. If you'll just sign up your name, and I'll give you a call. So.
We are coming up on that time of year again where Jeff and Kim and I go out to a, it's kind of hard to describe, it's kind of a art pagan festival out there in the deserts there in Nevada where there's about 70,000 people out there. We go out there and do missions missions work. We do dream interpretation, we do prophetic words, we do healing. We do all kinds of wild and crazy things out there that will probably never make this service. But we say all that to say, even though it's in the United States, it costs about as much as a modern-day missions trip to go overseas to get it done, because we have to rent RVs and we have to do all this, and you have to bring every bit of your own food, every bit of your own water, all those different things. And so we're trying to raise some funds for that, particularly Jeff and Kim. They're not here this morning, so I'll just brag on them a little bit. They have been very, very faithful doing this for the last several years, and they've actually stepped into more of a leadership role within the team where they are in charge of the coffee dome and serving the coffee. And it's a really big responsibility. They have to get there a little bit earlier than everybody else. Just to help set it up, because coffee and relationships work hand in hand. And if you don't know, coffee is the start of personal revival. How many of you know what I'm talking about? I didn't have coffee this morning. I almost put Gatorade on for deodorant. I was that tired. This is something that provides a place for people come and just meet and chill out. It's kind of like a coffee house there, in a way, out on in the desert, and then it leads into an encounter. So if you'd like to contribute that, just put Jeff and Kim on the on Burning Man on their funds, and let's send them off. We've seen a lot of fruit from these. We generally have anywhere from 13 to 25 people get saved every time we go out there, and because it's a place where people are open, right? I mean, people are hungry. And these are people that want to just disconnect from the world, basically, and do all kinds of things. We could go into that, but I'm not. So they're going to set up something. I think it'll be in the bulletin next week. We're preempting the bulletin because the event's coming up here pretty soon. So if you'd like to give into them, they'll have an account set up here at the church, and you can designate funds to that.
Also, Linda, you want me to remind you, we just purchased a bunch of books from Dutch Sheets on The Dream, Discovering God's Purpose for Your Life. It's a great book. Dutch writes books that are phenomenal because we found out men read them. So if anything a man will read, you can get into it, all right? In other words, it's very concise and to the point, and it's not too long. So we are actually working on a model here where we're going to help everybody in this congregation, everybody we come across, to help develop their dream and what God is going to do for their life with a vision statement and everything. So this is going to be a required reading for everybody. So I encourage you to buy that in the bookstore. So we ordered, I don't know how many you ordered, but we have them in our bookstore. I encourage you to get those. Okay. All right. Children, we're going to release our kids to children's ministry. Bless you, kids, as you go. And speaking of Wednesday night, if y'all heard that song, how'd y'all like that new song Lindy wrote about Be It Unto Me? I just think that's yes in my spirit. And I really felt like God wanted her to minister that message, be it unto me, like Mary. So I encouraged her yesterday, and she was so excited to be able to minister that Wednesday once the terror leaves her. But that'll be Wednesday. She's going to share that. And so be here Wednesday night. And then also the Mershbrocks here are going to be ministering next Sunday. I really feel like they're carrying something, obviously, always for our state. and for the kingdom. But I just love when they come because they help us in the times and seasons. I feel like they're like Issachars always. They live in the Issachar moment. And I want them to really keep pouring into us and really lay into us where we are, where we're going in the season ahead. Okay, you have your assignment. And I expect like tongues of fire and stuff like that. All right, that's all I want. So we'll expect that next week. Right. And thank everybody for praying for my mom. As you know, she's still in the hospital, but she's feeling really wonderful. She is probably the best she's felt in months. The diagnosis is bad, but I can say this, that, the Bible says that we, even though we go through the valley of the shadow of death, we'll fear no evil. Because thy rod and thy staff, it comforts me. And I can say I have experienced that rod and staff. So has my mom and all our family, and that there has been no fear of evil at all. And I'm not saying the enemy's not there, because he is, but I'm not fearing him, because the Lord is our rod and our staff. He's our comfort. And I just, it's amazing. You know, when you've been through this rodeo several times, which we have, you kind of get used to riding that bull. And you finally calm that bull down. You say, you calm down. You're not going to throw me off. I'm staying on. And that's what we've been doing. So thank you. Keep praying for her. She's at Highland. If you want to go see her, she loves visitors. Just stay 5-10 minutes, though. But don't park there. Just spend some time there. And just love on her. She'd appreciate that. All right. Thank you. Let's pray for this word this morning. Jesus, help Pastor Tim. Amen. All right. That's it. That's a good prayer, right? We've been talking about new levels. If you remember when I preached many years ago when I was here, it's been seemed like so long. But the Lord has really taken us new levels, and I know that without my heart. Even the words here this morning are so clear of where we're going. But I want to lay a foundation about what moves the heart of Jesus. We had a phenomenal message here Wednesday night from Chris McCaskill. If you weren't here, it was amazing. We're still laughing and crying from the meeting, but I encourage you to go on YouTube and watch that. But really, it's the same message about what the Lord's trying to say to us about where we're headed. And I just want to ask you that question, what moves the heart of Jesus? And I guess another question I would add to that, are you moving the heart of Jesus and bringing him pleasure? Natasha talked about that in her conference. You know, the Lord has a pleasure part of him. He has a soul. The word says that in the Hebrews. It says that his soul, he has a soul. I don't understand that theologically fully, but he has a place of pleasure and pleasing, and his love is part of that. I always say this, when we look at the love of Christ, it never moves. It's always the same. Just like a dad or a mom constantly loves their children, but they're not always pleased with their children. All right, so... And God, and the fact that you're that way, probably because you came from the Father, and he's that way too. And as parents, we do things to bring our children into alignment so they start bringing us pleasure. Okay? And so God's not any different in that. It's not that he needs the pleasure. It's just that this is a partnership we're called to do to change the world and change the earth. And if we'll all work together, we're going to do that. You know, one of the great wonders of relationship, especially marriage, is that when someone chooses to put aside their wants and their desires with a pure heart, I'm talking about with a pure heart, and commits themselves to your purpose and to help you obtain what you're doing without regard of what it costs them. That is one of the most incredible wonders in the world. It's almost like when somebody does that for you, you're like, why are you doing that? You know, I remember once when I was a new pastor, there was another local church here, and they were having a service with somebody we knew, a speaker. And so I told our church, I said, let's just cancel and go over there. And so we canceled our service, and we went over there. We actually brought more people than they had. And so we went in the meeting, and the pastor, he looked at me and asked me to sit in the front. He looked at me and goes, why are you doing this? And I said, because we love you, man. We love the Lord, and we just want a fellowship. And he was so... undone. Even during worship, he leaned over to me and goes, I can't believe you did this. And it's almost in his thought, like, what do you want from this? You know? And I didn't want anything. It was the joy of just fellowshipping. And I think that's sometimes it's an amazing thing that when somebody gives themselves to you and doesn't want anything in return. And what caused a person to do such thing? And in our society, what about their needs? What about their wants? And if I'm going to give to somebody else, what about my needs? Aren't we supposed to balance this all out? You do this for me, and I'll do this for you. It's all a cost-to-reward basis. And what most people walk in life is cost-to-reward. And so relationships that do that without a proven reward is like incredible. Look at Ezekiel and Isaiah, Jeremiah, guys like that who did exactly what they were called to do and got no reward, basically. They got put in prison. They got outcast. You know, if you want to call that a reward, you can put that in your category. I don't call that a reward, but they did it because why? Their love for the Father was greater than the reward. So what about a person who commits to help you with total disregard of any reward and finds their reward in the joy of committing to another person? That's a unique individual, isn't it? Psalms 139:15, we talked about that before, says you were made in the secret. And the word is secret place. And everything that was and is created was created by the spoken word of God. We all agree with that? Can we lay a theological line here? We all believe that everything that's created is created by his word. We believe that? Amen? Hebrews 11:3 says, by faith we understand the worlds were prepared by the word of God so that what is seen was not made out of things which were visible. So everything you see in the world, everything you see in this earth, was created by the word of God. Turn to Genesis chapter 1. We'll get to Revelation later. But if you'll get to Genesis chapter 1, that's the first book in your Bible. And y'all know these verses very well, but I want to read them because I really want to lay a context about what it takes to please the Lord. Verse 26. And it said, then God said, there are 10 times in this passage in Genesis that he says, then God said. So we believe there's at least 10 dimensions of everything that God does. So within you, when God created you, there's at least 10 dimensions in you. We live in a 3D world. You need to add 7 more to yourself. Okay? There are realms you haven't even touched of what God put in you yet. We use 10% of our brain, some less, but we use about 10% of our brain. Depends on what kind of day you're having and if you had your coffee or not, right? Verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our own image according, I love the us, let us, because Jesus was with him in the creations, and get this, so were you, because you were in him before the foundations of the earth. Now I want you to get this, and somehow in the spirit realm, you were a spirit being in heaven, and in that realm, when God said, let us make man, you were a spirit, and you saw what God did. So in that dimension of who you are is a reality, a revelation of what God did and his purpose of creating man. And you spend your life trying to get back to that purpose. You're trying to discover, why am I here? Why are you doing this to me, Lord? You know, things like that. And it says, according to our own likeness, let him, man, I just can't go past that. You get that? So you were there, and you saw God create man just like the likeness and image of man, of God. And then he leans over to you in the spirit and says, you too. It's not just Adam and Eve, it's you as well. Now you were a spirit, thank goodness, you didn't have any flesh yet, but you were a spirit. And in the secret place, God created you in his likeness and his image. Follow me here. And he says, and let them rule over the fish in the sea and over the birds in the sky and over the cattle of all the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So you even have authority over all the creeps. Okay? Now, I believe this verse was for Louisiana. because we have taken dominion over the fish and the cattle. Amen? All right. Even crawfish. All right, here we go. So, God, 27. God created man in his own image, and in the image of God, he created him, male and female. He created them. Nobody else. The devil didn't. You know, the Gnostics, the New Agers think that there was some other level of creation. There was not. He alone was the creator. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, amen, and fill the earth and subdue it and rule over the fish and the sea and over the birds of the sky, over every living thing that moves on the earth. So part of the creative purpose came with a commission. Now you were there. You may not know it. You were there. And within your spirit, man, there's full knowledge about the authority and dominion you're supposed to walk in. Now whether you manifest is not up to God, it's up to you. Personal responsibility, we're not into that anymore. All right. That's what our society says, right? Do you know in our society the victim is elevated in our society now? If they can play a sad enough song, you'll feel sorry for them, and we then send our resources to them rather than to the healthy ones who are changing the culture and society. We have elevated the victim. And we live in a victim mentality culture now. And that's not the way God doesn't spend much time with victim mentalities. When Jeremiah and Gideon, all these guys and Ezekiel complained about their problems and their issues, about when God commissioned them, and they'd say, well, I'm the least. I can't do this. I can't do this. When you read the scripture, God absolutely and totally ignores their comment. And they said, well, Gideon said, I'm the least of the least. And God said, great, valiant warrior, here's what you're going to do. You know, and like Gideon go, hey, did you not hear me? And God says, I don't listen to that because that's not what I created. And so that's your issue. That's not his. Isaiah 55, 11 says, now put this in your theological oven. We're going to cook it here. Isaiah 55, 11 says, so will my word which goes forth from my mouth, it will not return to me empty, without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding for the matter in which I sent it. Now, we know that scripture all the time. So when we prophesy, we always quote that, his word will not come back void. But the Lord's not really saying your word. He says his word. So when God, although all men contend with God and his desire, we all do, they will not be successful in defeating his purpose, that men will walk and manifest his image and his likeness. So when God said that man was made in my image and likeness and he'll rule over all the earth, he'll have dominion, that word is never going to stop moving until it's fully accomplished. It does not matter whether you fail or succeed in your endeavors. It will be fulfilled. And God is looking for a company of people that will do this, that will rule with him and will be seated with him in heavenly places. His will prevail. Y'all get that? And the only question is, will you be part of the company of people who look, walk, talk, and act like his image and his likeness? Because there's going to be a people that can and will and are doing that now. Otherwise, if that does not get fulfilled, God is a liar and the truth is not in him. Because he said, when I spoke this in Genesis 1, it's going to come to pass. So your life's purpose is to fulfill that word. And you manifest his image and likeness perfectly. You can't be perfect in yourself. Have you figured that one out yet? I'm going to give you license right now. Look at your neighbor and say, you are not perfect. All right? some husbands and wives are going to pay me later for allowing them to do that in church, all right? Yeah. Text her, brother. Anyway, you're not perfect. But
Everybody say but. God has the biggest but of all. Okay? But God. Now where'd your mind go? All right? The perfection of Christ lives in you and has the full ability to manifest perfection. And that's in one of your dimensions, in your spirit, man. It knows that. Because when you were in the beginning, when creation happened, and you heard him say, they're made in my image and likeness, his image and likeness is perfection. See, we think that, oh, it was Adam. He's the only one that got that gift. No, that was all man. He said, let us make man and woman. You were in that group. So, thus you must become the Word made flesh. Because when you're the Word made flesh, it lifts Christ up and all men will be drawn to him, not to you. We'd do a lot of good with idol worship if we'd lift him up. You know, us in the ministry have to fight that. In your careers, whatever you do, you have to fight that. Because you can lift yourself up and men will look to you. The greatest gift or greatest compliment you can ever have is somebody say to you, you were sent by the Father. That's the greatest you can have. Christ loved you before you ever loved him. He died for you while you were still a sinner. He didn't wait for you to get cleaned up. He was slain before the foundation of the earth, before you were even born. So his faithfulness and his word is without question. It's unquestionable. Can we just settle that? His love is settled. His faithfulness is settled. It's our faithfulness that's highly questionable. I am faithful at being unfaithful. And we have shown it, shown the capacity over in our life that we're going to do what we want regardless of his desires in the kingdom and for us individually. That's just the sad part of our journey. But that's our soul and our flesh. That's our spirit, our soul and our body. That's not your spirit, man. There is a raging war going on inside of you at all times. Romans 8 says it's a war. And it's the Spirit of God wrestling with you and your soul and your body to come into alignment. Your misery levels is based on your rebellion. So if you got a little rebellion, you know, misery meter going in your heart, it is not based on God's faithfulness. It's based on your rebellion. Mine too. Remember, he said, my word's going to accomplish what I sent it out to do. In other words, it's not going to stop working until it accomplishes it. So you can say, God, leave me alone. He'll say, never. You say, I don't want to serve you. Too bad. You're going to serve me. Get this person out of my life. No, I'm going to send more like them. God is going to do whatever it takes to bring you into his image and his likeness. Because that's what he said he was going to do, and his word is going to continually move to do that. Run as you may, he's faster than you. Usain Bolt lost a race last night, fastest man in the world. God can put a power in somebody else to pass you up. Some of y'all don't even know what I just said. All right. Remember my first statement about a person who commits to help you with total disregard to any reward. And their reward is finding the joy of committing to another. And here's the question. Do you serve the Lord based on a cost to reward basis? Or do you serve him because of the joy set for you is so much more that you're willing to take up your cross just like he did and follow him, conforming ourselves to his image? Remember, that's part of the deal. And it's not that we made a deal with God, but it is part of the call. I want to be like Jesus. Take up your cross. Well,
it's not about that part. I like the other part about Jesus. It's like all these people have replacement theology. The church has replaced Israel. And they all want to claim all the promises of Israel. I said, well, okay, that's fine. Claim that, but claim all the curses as well. And all that they have to suffer through disobedience. No, we don't want that. Well, then get rid of your theology then. It's not biblical anyway. But it's this whole thing. When we go in, it's a package deal. Amen? I'll just say amen to myself. When you are made in the secret place, follow me here. When you are made in the secret place, that secret place means a covering, a hiding, a protection, where the enemy was not invited, nor was he privy to the information that was installed in your data bank. So the enemy, when the spirit is in heaven and you're being created, in a sense, your purpose and your destiny, the image and likeness of God, the enemy's outside the door. He doesn't know what's going on inside of there. He's just waiting for you to come out. And when you come out with a soul and a body. That's when you come into the earth. You're here, all right? So now he's ready for you. And his whole issue is, I've got to get them to not believe what God created them to be. That's it. That's all I got to do. And so in the Song of Songs, the bride is invited into the king's chambers, or the secret place. Now, actually, when you study that out in the song, it is a chamber within a chamber. So if you come to my house, you come into my chambers, but then me and Susan's room is a chamber within the chambers. You're not invited in there. Because that's for intimacy. That's for relationship that you're not for. And I want you to get this. When God takes you into the secret place, it's not any place for anybody else or for the devil. It's for you to have intimacy. It's for you to have an encounter with the Lord. So it's a chamber within a chamber. Ezekiel says it this way, a wheel within the wheel. So it's a picture of the throne. There are those that will be at the throne, and then there's those that will be outside the throne. It says that in Revelation. It talks about those that are standing around the throne. Then there are those that are in the throne, the wheel within the wheel. The ultimate call, the likeness and image of Christ, the only way you're going to be formed that way is if you go in the wheel within the wheel. And most believers are just happy to hang around the cross. Give me salvation. That's enough for me. Are y'all still there? Your spirit was made in the perfect image and likeness of God, and we were given the tools, you were, to rule and reign and become the Word made flesh. I wish I could describe what that means. I don't have time today. But here's what happens. So you were created that way, and then corruption came to you, was added to your soul and your body when you were conceived by your parents. Aha, it's their fault, right? No, but I want you to understand this. The corruption that's in your soul and your body, whether it's physical problems or mental problems, whatever your issues are, it is absolutely no competition to the perfection that was woven and fabricated in your spirit, man, in the secret place. So that God put within your spirit, man, your spirit, soul, and body, everything it knows how to overcome the corruption that hits your soul and your body. Thus fulfilling the scripture, God will not put on you more than you can bear. Well, you don't know the family I got put in. Boy, like God's an idiot, didn't know that? Are you kidding me? So when God saw the family you were going to be assigned to, he wove in the fabric of your spirit, man, how to deal with those issues. Well, you don't know my family. They're this and this and this. It's all right. God knew it. He didn't weave it into me because he didn't put me in your family. Amen. And he didn't put you in my family. Amen. You have a grace to live in your family. You need it. If it wasn't for you, you'd be the only sane thing in your family, right? That's what they say about you too. Anyway, so no circumstance can cancel out the ability that is guaranteed success in you that was ordained in you before the foundations of the earth. If you'll take up your cross and you'll live for him, there, not for reward, but for the joy of knowing that it brings him pleasure. Now, we talked about humans doing that for us, but can you do that for Jesus? My greatest joy as a husband, Susan's not here, she's in Florida. My greatest joy for Susan is to know that I can deny myself and bring her pleasure. I've been trying to figure some things out for years, but what brings her pleasure? But there are certain mysteries in the world that only Jesus can answer. And vice versa, right? How much more should it be for us in the Lord that I deny all myself and the greatest joy I have is that I bring him pleasure? Wow. What does it do to the heart of Jesus when an individual denies all that they live, all in their lives, not that they deny everything, they don't live for themselves, but they live for him alone. What does that do to the heart of Jesus? Probably the first things that pop in your mind, it probably makes him happy. You know, Jesus, happy is not a biblical word. It's a key word in the seeker-friendly movement, but it's not a biblical word. God never says, I promise you happiness. Joy and happiness are two different things. We strive for happiness. He gives us joy. Joy is our strength. Joy lets you walk through a fire. So what does it do when we don't live for ourselves, but we live for him alone? The bride in the Song of Songs was walking in this type of abandonment. And the bridegroom responded this way. Listen to this, chapter 4, verse 9. This is how the bridegroom responded to a woman, or a person, a believer, a type and shadow, of somebody who's absolutely becoming totally abandoned for the Lord. He says this, you, speaking of the bride, have made my heart beat faster. My sister, my bride, you have made my heart beat faster with a single glance of your eyes. So when you go into the secret place with Jesus, and you go in there with reckless abandon, you've given your life to the Lord, and you live for him alone, not for what he can give you. When you look in his face, it says it makes his heart beat faster with even just the glance of your eyes. Because why? He's seeing his own eyes in you. Wow. In the sixth chapter of that book, he even asked the bride, he says, turn your eyes away from me because I'm overwhelmed with the level of reckless abandonment and commitment that you've denied everything in the earth for me. Just like it's more than I can handle. And that's hard to believe our Lord would do that. But in a sense, we do that when somebody does that for us. We have the same encounter. Like, look, I'm not even worthy to look at you. Here you are denying everything for me, and I'm just undone by that. So what does it take to please Jesus, to bring him pleasure? There's one of the answers. Are y'all with me? What is the ultimate desire of Jesus in the earth? You know, I'll give you my own testimony and we'll shut this down. I've shared it here before, but back in the 90s, 95, 96, I was just hungering for God. Most of us were. We were just desperate for a move of God. Charismania was not cutting it. And so my friend and staff down there at Pensacola at the revival said, you need to get down here. And I said, Jesus is in Shreveport. She said, that's true, but there's something here. Yeah, that's right. So she begged and she pleaded with me for months and months. And so I finally went. Me and Susan went. Stayed at their house. And we went. And I walked into this building, 2,200 people. and just in worship, and I had never, ever in my life felt the presence of God that way. And I thought, what have I walked into? And I looked around the room, and these people were doing some weird stuff. I mean, weird stuff. People shaking, and there was people laughing, there was people rolling, and I'm like, oh my God. But Lord, you're here. So I had a dilemma, a personal dilemma. I wanted God, but I didn't want that. I wanted God on my terms. Reckless abandonment was my words, but personal commitment was a battle. It wasn't until later that I recognized that my battle with the manifestations was not me and God, it was me and man. And it was my fear of what man would think of me if I lived a reckless, abandoned life where he could take over my body. Because I wanted to be in control. All the gifts, miracles, all the Pentecostal blessings of Acts 2 forward, healing, tongues, whatever you want to call it, prophecy. When somebody says this, I don't need those things to be a Christian, or I don't need those things in my walk of the Lord, I'm happy where I am. Do you understand? You're denying everything he gave you to help you become in his image and his likeness. And you will never make it without him. Well, I don't need that stuff. Well, yeah, you do. And you say you believe in God and you believe everything in his Bible, but you don't believe that. Or you say, Holy Spirit, you're cool, but stay over there. Show up when I'm at church, not at work. Show up in my bedroom, not at Walmart. Okay? Because then I'll be embarrassed. Are y'all with me? So there I was, and I remember we were there for days. I mean, and I was just, the God, the glory was so phenomenal. And I go home at night and say, God, I still want you. I still want all of you, but I just don't want that. Can you give it to me without that? Let's make a deal. Door number three. Some young people have no clue about that one either. So finally, one night, I think it was the third night or fourth night, I think we're getting ready to leave. My friend had the evangelist, Steve Hill, pray for me. She says, I want him to pray for you. I said, okay. I want you, Lord, but I don't want that. And he put his hands on me, and something happened. The Bible says, let no man lay hands on you suddenly. And I made a mistake. I let him lay his hands on me suddenly. And I remember, all I can remember was my spirit man took over and my soul and my body came into alignment under my spirit. No longer was my soul able to say, I don't want that, because my spirit now was leading me. That's why it says if you walk by the spirit, you won't give in the lust of the flesh. So if you give in the lust of the flesh, you're just out of alignment. You get that? And so I got in that moment, and it just had a weak moment. And I yielded to the Holy Spirit, and he whacked me. All I remember was I blacked out. That's all I can remember. All these people call it slaying the spirit. They can call it whatever they want. I blacked out. I didn't fall properly. You know, I didn't do the nice courtesy fall and all that. I just collapsed. I don't even think there was a catcher there. You didn't follow protocol, brother. And when I woke up, something was in me that wasn't in there before. And it was a joy unspeakable, full of glory. I could not explain it. I was shaking like a fish out of water. And I'll never forget, I was at the altar, and there's a bunch of ladies, older ladies on the front row. And they were laughing their heads off. And I said, they are laughing at me, God. This is embarrassing. But that the joy was so great, I go, oh, well. What's it matter? You know, when you guys used to get drunk, you were that way. You lost care for everything when you got a little bit on that in your system. This was better than that because I wasn't going to have a hangover. And it just overwhelmed me. I mean, I couldn't stop. I was just like, this joy, I stopped. No, it's good. No, stop. No, no, it's good. So I walked, I crawled to my friend at the altar. I said, how do you stop this? And her answer was, you can't. It has a life of its own. That's what the Spirit has. It has a life of its own, not your own. So I remember I went home that night to her house, and I was in my bed, and Susan had to get, I had to get out of bed because I was one of those quarter, put a quarter in it, vibrates your bed, you know, thing. Some of y'all don't even know about that. But anyway, you remember you used to go to hotels, you put a quarter in the bed. What the heck was that? Anyway. And I was laying in bed, and I said, God, why did you do that to me? And he said, son, I needed to shake the pride out of you. You're so full of it. Yeah, God said I was full of it. And I had determined what my walk with him was going to be like. And he shook me, and I shook, and I shook, and I shook for months. I couldn't even think about God. If I thought about God, the Spirit of God would hit me. So I would just drive around thinking about baseball or just like something carnal. If I could just think about something carnal, I wouldn't feel God and I wouldn't act like an idiot. So I'm not lying. I did. And then I'd start, and I'd play a worship song and that was it. It was all over. I was like in that same place I was when I was on the floor. And the Lord said, you can abide there. If you're in my image and my likeness. So everything in creation would come back to alignment of Genesis 1. That's what God's trying to do. That man would walk with God as Adam did before he sinned. Let me close with this. When the Bible says, the English translation says, Adam walked with God in the cool of the evening. We love that verse, don't we? Like, wow, the garden had California weather. You know, that's what it sounds like, right? Just perfect. Must have been 70 degrees all the time. Awesome, right? That's not what the word means. I don't know why the English translators did that. It doesn't have, I don't even know how they came up with cool when you read the translation. It was anything but cool. The word is ruach, which is the wind of God. It's the breath of God. So it says Adam walked with the breath of God every day. The wind of God was on him every day. So that meant that to be in his image and his likeness, he had to have the same breath as God did. He had to be walking in the breath of God every day. So every breath he relied on was the breath of God, perfection functioning through and in him. He was the Word made flesh. He first Adam before he sinned was the Word made flesh. Everything God said about man was fully fulfilled in Adam before he fell. So what did God have to do to straighten this mess out that he put us in is that he sent the day of Pentecost, which was a wind, to put us back in the place that Adam was before he fell. Babel, which was all the tongues got twisted because they were trying to bring back in the earth the same thing that was in the days of Noah. And God had to stop it, and he babbled the languages. Pentecost brought all the languages back together. Because God is going all the way to Babel then so he's just a short jump back to the garden. Okay? Like at home, it's going to hit you, and you're going to start shaking like I did. All right? It'll hit you later. When someone says they don't need those things, you need everything God has, all right? He died for those gifts. He died for those things that you don't want. Revelation says that the kingdom of this world will become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. And the last thing is Psalms 2. That's when Jesus asked the Father for the nations as an inheritance and the ends of the earth his possession. If, listen to me, this is going to hit you right between the eyes. It did me. If this is not your desire, then you're not going to be part of the company that makes the Father's heart, Jesus' heart, beat faster. Because you're not willing to abandon all. You love your life. You love your stuff. You want him, but you want him at a level. We're all guilty of this. It doesn't mean he doesn't love you. Get over that. That's settled. He loves you. It just means that your life will be one lacking full, will be lacking full of purpose. Because your spirit man was made to be in that secret place that knows what you're called to live for, but then you will choose not to, so you cannot live, and you will never live in perfect peace. Nor will you live in the perfect will of God. You'll live at a level of his will, but never his perfect will. So, that's it. I'm through. So what does it take to please the heart of Jesus? Giving him the nations as an inheritance and the ends of the earth his possession, and that the kingdom of this world become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ. So your personal mission, your personal vision statement, whatever God's called you to do, if it's not headed toward accomplishing that, then you have a selfish vision. So, well, I'm called to be a teacher. Amen. You're called to be a teacher. What's your purpose in being a teacher? My job as a teacher is to make sure that all the nations come to Jesus. That all my students come into the kingdom of God, and everything that their families live for is to become a possession for Jesus. That really narrows your vision down. It does. Senator, you're here today. Your vision is to bring Louisiana into alignment with the kingdom of God. That's your job. And it's not easy because in those environments, everybody else wants to take it out of the kingdom of God. But that's your job. Your personal vision statement must be a part of that. The image and likeness of Christ is to give Jesus everything. All right. So what do you think? Is it good? All right. Y'all want to get saved? Here we go. We're all guilty, 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 right? Of living for ourselves, living our life, and it is a progress, it's a progression. And if you, the more you surrender, the more joy you're going to experience without wanting the cost benefit. Right? Term insurance, right? You buy term insurance, you don't collect, you don't accumulate anything. Somebody else gets the money. It's not for you. But you leave an inheritance for somebody else. Can you deny yourself for somebody else? Somebody sells insurance in here, that'd help you. Amen. Let's stand up. You used to sell insurance, didn't you, Raj? Yeah, yeah. He got saved, yeah. That's good. Wow. Let's catch this wind. Come sing that song again, Lindy. That's a good song. Let's catch the wind here. John, you want to say anything? Jimmy, Karen, you got anything? Catch it. This is the new level. We're going to the new level. Amen? We're going to the new level, and the new level is I'm going to be in his image and likeness. I'm going to yield, and this war inside of me is going to stop. I'm tired of this war. I'm tired. You know, the scripture says that the spirit's willing, but the flesh is weak, right? How many times have you quoted that? How about reversing that? The flesh is weak, but the spirit is willing. Just reverse it. Okay, I know you're weak, but the spirit's willing. And the spirit in me is greater than the flesh in me. Amen?
Is this wind? The scripture popped into my head. It says, I think it's in Ecclesiastes, where it says, cast your bread upon many waters, and after many days it will return to you. And as we sing this song, I want you to just start thinking about how the Lord's going to cause the wind to bring back the things that you've sown. Bring back those things to you that you've cast, maybe a lot. I've just felt just a prompting that the Lord wanted you to know that this morning. So as we sing this, catch the wind. Know that wind. Think about, Lord, those things where I sowed, and it was just, I just did it. It wasn't anything special. He blows those things back to you.
I want you to do this. Get your offering ready. And I want you to come and worship and just put your offering in here. And I want you to go over here and get communion. And Walter, if you'll help us over there. And let's take communion today, or give our offerings and give our communion, and say, Lord, I need you in me, Christ in me, to help me win this battle of my flesh and my soul. I want to please you, Jesus. I want you to have pleasure. I want you to be pleasurable by our actions, our abandonment, with no guaranteed reward. If you say, is that biblical? Because I just want to read all the promises. Just go read Ezekiel. And take an Ambien afterwards. Because it's just so depressing that he did all this and got nothing out of it in the natural. We can't measure any reward he got on earth in Ezekiel's life, not one. But it says in Ezekiel, one of the last verses, he said he did all that the Lord asked him to do. We need to change our focus in the kingdom, because we've become a cost-to-reward kingdom mentality. There are always rewards. Seek first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, right? Where does it say, seek these things, they'll be added unto you? It says, seek the kingdom of God. And so, Father, we lift up your name right now, and this moment we're in right here on Sunday, August 6, 2017. We want this to be a day of commitment. We sow our offerings. We sow our hearts. But more importantly, we sow our lives to you. We're so thankful that we were made in your image and your likeness. We're so thankful that you died for us while we were yet sinners. You loved us before we ever loved you. And Lord, we want to show you our gratitude, our thankfulness by serving you with a broken and contrite spirit. You said you won't despise. And I declare that, Lord, with your strength, we can do it. Because your word says it will not come back void. It will accomplish what it's sent out to do. And you said we will become overcomers. You said in Jeremiah that nothing is too difficult for you. And we declare the power of breakthrough to bring us to this reckless abandonment for you, and that we would bring your heart pleasure, Lord. And we surrender our hearts to pleasure now in Jesus' name. Amen. As they worship, just come and give your offering, take your communion. We got some bread here. here. We need somebody by this one. And then we'll just worship. And go back to your seat, and we'll take communion together. Go ahead.
Oh, I am strong and full of life, and I am steadfast, no compromise. I lift my sails to the sky. I'm gonna catch the wind. I'm gonna catch the wind.
I just want to read this scripture. Basically, what I ministered this morning is in Romans 8. I want you to just go read it later. But just listen to these words. So then, brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if we are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit we are putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who have been led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, and that's why we cry out, Abba, Father. And the Spirit himself testifies within our spirit that we are the children of God. That's what happened in the creation. And if children, heirs, and also heirs of God and fellow heirs of Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, so we may be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Now get this. For the anxious longing of creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope that the creation itself also will be free from its slavery to corruption into freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans
and suffers the pains of childbirth together until now. That's that war that's going on inside of you to bring you into this. You're in suffering childbirth pain. Not only this, but we ourselves having the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves grown within ourselves, waiting eagerly for the adoption of sons, the redemption of our body. For in hope we have been saved, but hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is already seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, with perseverance we eagerly wait on Him. Well, that's a whole sermon. I just wanted to read it. The Spirit says, next verse says, the Spirit helps our weaknesses. And He intercedes us with groanings too far or too deep for words. So this war that's going on inside of you is not God's war, it's yours. God allows you to walk in futility until you come into your creative purpose. And it's all about war to death to self. I'm not a slave to corruption. Amen? I'm not a slave to sin. We sing that song. I'm not a slave to it anymore because of what Jesus did for us through this body and through this blood. So we take His body right now. A man that walked not in corruption, who was God fully, Jesus Christ, who was tempted in all ways and sinned not. And if anybody had a right to not die, it was Him, but He died. And when we take this bread in symbolically, what we're doing is we're taking in the life of Christ. We're being baptized in Him so that everything that He is in us. And so, Lord, we take this communion often because we forget this often. And He says, as often as you do this, remember Me. Remember. Bring His member back to you. So if we got out, we get back in. So, Father, we remember You today and what You suffered, Jesus. Thank You for that. And, Lord, let this corruption that has tried to overtake our minds and our bodies be removed by the power, the perfection of the cross. And we take this bread in that revelation in Jesus' name. We take this cup, the shed blood. This is the only way you get this stuff, is by His blood. So, Lord, we lift up the cup and we say thank You that You were that person that, with no guarantee of reward, the joy set before You, You endured the cross. You didn't know whether men would accept You or not accept You. But You made an offering of Your life, and You spilled Your blood. And now millions and millions have said, yes, Lord. And we are some of them. We say, yes, Lord. We receive what You did for us in this cup in Jesus' name. And we're going to catch this wind.
Okay, how many of y'all remember Paul Harvey? Okay, I'm going to tell you the rest of the story. Here's the rest of the story that he didn't tell. Pastor Tim since before 96. So I knew him when he was back in the youth, and Karen and I helped him and Susan back there. And he told you that he went to Pensacola, and he told you what happened. The rest of the story is this. Pastor Tim submitted to the Spirit. And then with everything within him, decided to do what he knew, same thing we know, what he preached about today. He decided to let the Spirit literally take over and walk in what he's called to walk in. That means to reach that place that he was created for. And that's what he's doing this week. And we as a body of believers. believers, we can come into agreement with that, participate in that, to help him move toward what he's called to do. That's part of what he was talking about today. We do something, not expecting a reward for it, but pushing him towards what he is called to do. That's what we're doing here, okay? He's called to go to the nations. He's going to the nations. He's been to the nations. He's going to continue going to the nations. That's what he was created to do. So what we would like to do is we would like to send Pastor Tim out, Apostle Tim out, to the nations as a body in agreement that he is going for his destined purpose in the nations. So if you would, please stretch your hands out. Father, I thank you for my friend. I thank you for your anointed one who you predestined to go to the nations, to go fulfill his destined purpose. And Father, we agree as a body. Say it, we agree. We agree that we are sending Apostle Tim out to fulfill his destined purpose in other countries. And Lord, we are coming into agreement with you. We are supporting and praying for this one to go out and to do what he's called to do. And God, we thank you that we're a part of that. We thank you that he is a part of us and we are a part of him. And Lord, we were destined to help support that. So Father, we are agreeing that we are walking in our destined purpose to help support that. So Father, we thank you that your will be done here on this earth as it is in heaven. And your purposes will be fulfilled. Your word will not return void. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thank you. That means a lot. I'll just give this testimony because I'm struggling. It's been a tough week because we're going to Eastern Europe to deal with Israel and to pray for Israel to come into the kingdom. And I said to myself at 3 in the morning, something this morning, I was crying. I said, God, what kind of son leaves his mom in the hospital and goes to the nations? And for an hour, I just tossed and turned and screamed to the Lord. And finally, he got me to shut up. And he said, she birthed you in that. That's what all her intercession was about, to get you into the nations, because it was prophesied over to you when you were young. And she's the one that drug you to those meetings where you got prophecy at. And the Lord says, look at the clock. And I did, and it was 4:14. Says, you're born for a time such as this. Because my heart, when I cried out, I said, God, I just want to bring the nations to you. That's all I want to do. Because that's your inheritance. And so with a heavy heart, I know if things go wrong, I just come home early, but I just know that she's in God's hands. And I remembered Ezekiel. You know, Ezekiel had so many bad things going, and then the only good thing in his life was his marriage. And then God says, I'm taking your wife, I'm taking her home, and you can't mourn that day, you have to preach that day. As Ezekiel did everything the Lord asked him to do. And I heard this, the God of Ezekiel is my God. I didn't get a different one. Okay. So pray for me in my strength and my soul. And for my mom too. And she said, I'll miss you, but that's what you're called to do. I said, okay. She goes, it's my fault, isn't it? And I said, yes, it is. So, Father, I speak this abandonment heart on this house. That we'd be all like Ezekiel's. To get with the will within the will. We don't want to just be on the will. We want to be within the will. We want to abandon people. If you need that today, just come and get some of that. Just receive some of that. Can you do I'm Not a Slave to Sin? You know that song? And we'll close with that. Father, I just speak life over everybody here. I just declare your goodness. I'm not a slave to sin. Father, I just speak your goodness over us. I just declare that Shreveport, Louisiana, and Louisiana's estate and in this America will come into its alignment. And we're going to be used as your vessels of honor, and we're going to obey you. I just feel like I'm supposed to lay hands on people that just, you know, you've not surrendered all. That's the best way I can put it. You've been fighting God. And just like I got whacked in Pensacola, you can get whacked here. I'm not telling you what's going to happen to you. You may feel nothing. But I believe an impartation will come. I just want to lay hands on you. And our team here will pray as well. So we'll close with this. Father, send us home today in the power of your might. And those that need prayer, we open the altars to that prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. Rest of you, you're released.
Of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone.
And I suggest you have your phones too, because we're going to prophesy over you.
From my